Former President Goodluck Jonathan expresses that ballots should choose our political leaders and that the winners-take-all syndrome has made politics very dangerous. And opposition party PDP believes that President Buhari's incapacity to govern a nation is increasing the negative situations in the country. Well, this is Plus Politics, and I am Mariana Cohn. Former President Goodluck Jonathan has called for the strengthening of the nation's political terrain and electoral process. He asked that the laws make a way for the political leaders of the nation to be chosen by ballot instead of the courts. He also stated that the winner-takes-all syndrome in our political terrain has made the environment so dangerous that women are often unable to actively participate. Well, joining us to have this conversation is Dikpo Olaiku. He is a broadcast journalist, he's a journalist. And of course, we have Adewale Adekoya. He's a political analyst. Thank you very much for joining us, Mr. Dikpo.
Yeah, good evening.
So I'm going to start with you. The winner takes it all syndrome. It didn't start today. This has been the business of the day in Nigeria's political terrain. It seems to be more and more pronounced in today's politics. I mean, we've seen it even within political parties. Early this year, we saw the drama that ensued within the APC while they were having the registration, a re-registration process. I mean, we've also seen rancor and drama within the PDP lately. We've seen crisscrossing and disagreements. It's not necessarily a new thing, but why, one would wonder, is it becoming more and more pronounced in today's politics?
Yeah, thank you very much. Like you have rightly said, it has always been part of our politics. Actually, if you look at the type of politics that we play, we are practicing presidential system of government. At national level, you have the president, and the constitution says that he shall be the chief executive of the country. And the constitution goes further to say that he shall appoint people that will serve him. And under section 8 or so, he talked about the executive powers of the president. That all the executive power belongs to him, and he can delegate it to whoever he likes, right from the vice president to the ministers and even the heads of ministries and paratepas. And you see, because of our elections are very, very expensive. Interestingly, the former president made allusion to that as well, because he has seen it all. He has been there. That's why in that paper, he said he started as a deputy governor. He rose to become the governor, later the vice president, and then finally president. So he has seen it all. Because if you look at the cost of our politics, of our elections especially, at times, when an individual is able to foot the bill, then unfortunately, they see it as an investment. And so there's something they call returns on investment. So the person believes that the amount of money he spent while prosecuting the campaigns, which culminated in his success at the polls, that he need to recoup that money. Mm. And if, on the other side, if he was not able to get enough funds to foot the bill of his campaigns, this is where some donors come in. And unfortunately, the donors that we call Godfather in some other climes, the donors are like Shylock. They want to take a pound of flesh. So they believe, like I said, it's an investment. So they must recoup the money they spent.
Where do we get that idea of it being an investment? When did leadership and stewardship all of a sudden equal to, you know, a business venture investment of sorts where we have to have some plowed back profit? When did we get to this point?
Yeah, because the president also made, the former president made mention of the expensive, the cost of running elections in Nigeria. And unfortunately, The electorates, they are not helping matters, that is the voters. When you go out on campaigns as a candidate or as a contestant, after the campaigns, unfortunately in our climate in Nigeria here, the voters believe that after the campaigns, you must take care of their logistics. And that is one. On the day of election, the voters believe that after all, you guys, when you get there for the next 4 years, we are not likely to have access to you. So whatever I can take, I must take it now. So that is why the issue of stomach infrastructure came in. It can be in whatever, in any form. It can be in the form of a raw cash so that you can have what they call an edible kesebe, that is vote and be able to prepare a pot of soup. Or what some people will do by slicing or opening a loaf of bread, inserting money inside it. So the voter itself has taken the benefits of the democracy for the next 4 years. So the man who used his money to do all these things believed that he has to take the money back because it is no more a service. It is an investment because he bribed you. Let us use the word, I'm using the word advisedly. He compromised you before he was able to get your vote. So he believed that when he gets into office, he has to recoup the money back. So, and you see, there could be other areas where they said maybe proportional representation. That is, okay, let us assume in an election, if the winner scores 50%, then the number of people he will appoint will be equal to that 50% of the votes he has got. Mm-hmm. And then the second person, maybe if he scores 30%, then the number of ministries allocated to the party will be 30%. But we're not practicing that. Mm-hmm. The party, the conditions that we are operating, says the president is the chief executive. And he appoints those who he thinks he can work with them. And when he delegates his power, because all the powers belong to him according to Section 8 of the Constitution, all the executive power. So he delegates this power to whoever he likes. So that is the type of democracy we operate. I don't know how we are going to come about what the vice former president was saying. Probably that is the proportional representation, so that you deallocate offices according to the percentage of votes that you have. We tried it under the NPN and NPP. There was a name they called for it. I think something like an alliance then. Within 2 years, the thing broke down. NPP went on its way, NPN went its way, and NPA took over the government. So alliances, to some extent, have not really worked. Hmm. But I think what matters most, which the former president was talking about, is service to the nation.
Okay.
Which you also asked that question, that when did elections become an investment? Somebody who comes out to say, okay, I'm going to do this for you, must see it as a service to the nation. That is why the former president, late Musa Yar'Adua, called himself servant leader. Because we are the people that voted for this person to go into office. So if at the end of 4 years, we find you wanting, we can decide to say, okay, you're not going back. So as at the time you are there, you are our servants. Mm. So you are there to render service. But unfortunately, the type of politics we are playing in Nigeria, nobody remembers what you have done in the last 4 years. What they remember is, okay, this man is from my zone. This man is from my ethnic group. This man is from my religious, he's a Christian, I'm a Christian. So whether he performed or not, I must vote for him.
So all of that, so of course, clouds, yeah.
It is not only on the part of the politicians. Even we voters, we are corporates in this mess that we are finding ourselves.
Let me move on to some other things. He made a lot of interesting points. And this is the whole month of March, we were celebrating the women. It was the Women's History Month. And of course, it's also a month where you celebrate the International Day of a Woman. And there were conversations around women stepping up to the plate and, you know, getting involved in politics. Now, the former president did say that the women folk have not necessarily gotten the kind of platform that they deserve and the type of attention that they deserve in the political terrain. In fact, he said the political terrain in Nigeria is making it difficult for women to even participate in the political process. And I want to ask, why do you think it's been, I mean, we're in 2021, we're in the 21st century, where the free world has a woman, the first woman vice president. Former President Goodluck Jonathan, under his administration, there was that movement for 35%, you know, affirmative action, which, I mean, I still question, why 35%? Why can't we have 40 or 50? But what's your take on this issue as to women, you know, and the challenge of being absorbed or making it a welcomed environment for women to play? I'm talking about the politics in Nigeria.
Yes. Let me begin with the 35% affirmative action. You know, it's a product of what they call the Beijing Conference. So if we have graduated to 35, maybe by the time they hold the next conference, maybe we are going to graduate to 30 or 40 or 45. But like I said at the inception, at the beginning of this program, politics is an investment. And you are remunerated or compensated on the basis of your investment. Investment can be in form of money. It can be in form of time. It can be in form of intellectual capability, what you contribute to the intellectual process of the campaigns. But unfortunately, in our climate, and because of the setup, the setting that we have, the former president also mentioned it, that most of the political meetings are held in the dead of the night. Most of the political meetings where decisions are made, both at party level, at government level, they are always held in the middle of the night. And you see, by virtue of the nature of a woman, either as a mother or as a wife, it would not be almost impossible for that same woman to have time to be at the meeting, the political meeting, around 2 a.m., 3 a.m. Where will you tell your husband you are going for? What are you going to do? Where will you tell your children?
I'm sorry, I don't want to sound like a feminist because I'm not one, but I support everything that the women stand for. Why does the woman have to explain herself if her husband understands that she's a politician? Does the woman ask the man to explain when he's running for the same office and going for those meetings? Isn't that where the problem begins?
No, it is very, very unfortunate. That is the way nature has a program.
Is it really nature?
Because let me give you an instance. You have a male and a female child. As a mother or as parents, you know the type of liberty you will give to the male and then to the female. Because of the nature of a lady, they believe that there are certain things you should not move around where danger lurks. And it is always believed that in the night, danger lurks everywhere. Yoruba will say, "Enyabire kiniru, dakumo kinin loson." That is, somebody that is from a good home does not go about in the dead of the night. But the politicians move around in the dead of the night. The question you ask yourself, is this safe for a woman in case of any eventuality? Will it be safe for a woman to be found outside in the dead of the night around 2 a.m., 3 a.m.? And that is when the politicians move around. That is when they hold meetings where they determine the fate of their party and the fate of the country. You see, some of those people who have access to people in government, they will tell you that there are some governors don't go to bed until 4 a.m. the following in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning. How many women will be out there that the husband will not be asking questions? Even the family will be asking, what are you doing outside? Are you not supposed to be at home with your husband? So that is some of the areas that have handicapped the women into investing their time into political activities.
Okay.
That is why when decisions are being taken, most of the time they are not there. Because the decisions are taken at what some people call ungodly hours.
Okay.
That is why this affirmative action that has said, okay, whether you like it or not, whether the woman was present at the time of meeting or not, 35% of your cabinet must always be reserved for the women.
Okay.
So that the women will not be changed. Like I said, maybe we'll graduate into 40, 45% and possibly 50%.
We're looking forward to that. We're just being joined on the phone by Mr. Adewale Adekoya. He's a political analyst. Mr. Adewale, my next question is to you. I just want to do a follow-up on what Mr. Olayokun has said. Now, the former president, Goodluck Jonathan, went ahead to say that the political environment is yet to be sanitized, that politicians believe that it's easier for men to play rugged politics. I'm still talking about women now. And that, you know, just like Mr. Olayokun said, it's at night that the men, you know, hang out and make all the decisions that they want to make. And he says, so it's better and easier for men to choose men because they feel that they can, you know, level with them on a particular issue. But how long do you think it will take for us as Nigeria, as a country, to begin to open up that space for women? Should the women be waiting for the space to be opened up for them? I know that you're not a woman, but I'm sure you have women in your life and you understand, you know, how important it is for women to get involved in this space. How long will it take for political parties to allow women to have a level playing field? Because this is something that's very important to not just, you know, you and I, but the world at large. You know what they say, that men who have been in politics have made a mess of it and women have to come and clean it up.
I'm with you.
Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much. Once again, I am Adewale Ademola Justus.
Okay.
Now, to the issue we are discussing, I want everyone to pay attention to the fact that in Africa and in our climate, there's what we term the masculinity of politics. Masculinity of politics. Mm-hmm. The politics we have around here is meant to be played by men who have the muscles and the skills for the game. That is why you see most of us who adduce the politics of our climate to being dirty. Many people will say politics is dirty. It is dirty because of our culture. It is dirty here because of the mechanism with which we play it. So you will see, not until our cultural sentiment changes, we may not have a space for women to play. And like the other speaker was saying, see, in sincerity, where would a woman tell her husband she's heading to in the dawn of the night? I wouldn't know if you have read Malam Nasir El-Fai's book on an accidental public servant.
Yes, I have.
Yeah, you will see most of the meetings held by the politicians at the wee hours of Olusegun Obasanjo's days, they took place in the dawn of the night. Bullion vans were moved in the night. Meetings took place in very discreet places in the night. And you know, that is one of the unique features of what a man and a male can do. A woman cannot feature in that. And again, you will see.
I beg to differ. There were women in that. There were women in that cabinet. I'd like to gracefully tell you that we had a Florence Itagiwa who ran in that particular circle, and she was a woman. So when you make it sound like, oh, this is a boys' club, the women are not allowed to play, it sounds very sexist.
You see, politics is a game of number. We are not saying absolutely there is no female in the group. But where it is not significant, you can't say that is successful of having females in their midst. So because of the ways and manners we play the politics of today, in Nigeria and in Africa particularly, the women may not have a space yet. But like I was saying, I was trying to say, you see, politics is a reward syndrome for earlier participation. It is a reward syndrome. You see, Okonjo-Iweala, Obi Ezekwesili, and this other woman, they were there, they did it, but you could see what it took them and what it cost them to get to that level. How many of our women can run such a race? So as the days are rolling by, as the politics is advancing and developing, we are seeking, because power and politics is never end a la carte. You have to contribute reasonably before people would have to remember that, oh, once a time you were there, and now you have to be brought in to enjoy
Adewale, I want to take you up because I'm sorry, I'm going to now have to be the mouthpiece of the women today. You sound like the women cannot, they should not. This is how you sound, even though you're trying to make a case for the women, but you sound like they can't. And you keep saying, how many women can do this? There are so many women, I'd like to put it to you, who are very capable.
I said, power and politics is not an a la carte.
Exactly. I would like to also put it to you that who are the people who galvanize these people to come out and vote? Who are the people who galvanize these other people to come and be part of campaigns? The women. The women.
So again,
women have been the core foundation of political parties, haven't they?
Hello, women representatives.
So when you say a la carte, it sounds like the women just want to drop their mark and become members of political parties.
Women only come to play in campaign at the basal part. The basal part.
No. Like I said, there are women in those political parties, but then they're not given as much as... I mean, I may be wrong, but
I'm certain. They are insignificant.
Why?
Financially, systemically and administratively, they are insignificant. The men take the bold steps and do the main things.
Why do you think they're insignificant? Why? I'm still yet to hear.
I was part of a political drum rolled out a few years ago. Mm-hmm. In the course of all our meetings, I can tell you categorically, we have less than 5% women in armies.
Maybe your party was sexist?
We did all those things as men. So if the power came as we sought, the reward system would only be the flood lamp on those that took part in building up the game. So it is an advice, given the opportunity of speaking this evening, for our women to begin to walk out of their shells. Hello? Mm-hmm. Women to begin to walk out of their shells and seek to be part of the polity.
What about it's the men? What about the men that the men you said would question their whereabouts? You're saying women should come out of their shelves. But of course, these same men are society. They make up society. They make up the husbands and those people who raise eyebrows to say, where are you going this night? So when you call on the women in that same breath, can you call on the men?
Hello, do you know what they call responsibility?
Educate us, please.
Yep. Responsibility, I said. It is knowing what is to be done and moving ahead an inch to do what is supposed to be done. If a woman has demonstrated so much competence and confidence and ability of doing it, even a blind husband will see that she can do it. Are we together? Mm-hmm. Hello?
I can hear you. Go ahead, please.
I said, if a woman shows enough and sufficient competence to make the husband feel and know that, oh, I can do it, even a blind husband would allow the woman to go ahead.
Okay.
But you know, there's this frailty with the woman's sex. There's this loss of confidence in when a woman moves ahead. But if women or our women these days are able to competently show the men and show the people of the polity that they can do it, I can tell you, like I said, power is not saved or earned a la carte. You work for it, you earn it. Show sufficient demonstration of capabilities.
Okay.
The system will permit you.
All right, well, because we're almost out of time, we have just a few seconds, so I'm going to pose the same question to you and Mr. Olayokun. The former president talked about the issue of electoral reforms and why people must insist that, you know, the Electoral Act is being enforced, especially the one that's lying on Mr. President's table that needs to be signed. But my question is, why do our former presidents wax lyrical when they leave office, when you are a president of the country? Like you said, Mr. Olayokun, you're a very powerful person. You can do anything. But they don't do these things. And then when they are out of office, they're very quick to say, oh, this is what I think you should do and this is what you should do. But why didn't you do it, Mr. President, when you were in office? I'll start with you, Dikpo.
You see, I like the way you put it. You said when you are the president, you are a very powerful person to us outside. Let us be sincere with ourselves. That man you see there that is sitting on that seat as the president is not the only one in charge. That is just the practice since the beginning. You see, there are certain things that there are some facts that we're not away from, whether we like it or not. Let me use the word that there are some people that own Nigeria, and they are always like a recurring decimal. They are every day in all governments. You can call them the Kaba, you can call them the Godfather, but those are the people that are the power behind the throne. That man you see there as the president is only there as a figurehead, not per se. So whatever action he wants to take, he has to be conscious of his surroundings. Let me give you an instance.
Quickly.
When there was this issue
of subsidy
in 2012, and there was that problem all over. You know, the then president, that is Dr. Goodluck Jonathan, he said the people behind the oil subsidy, that if I name them, they will come after me. That is just to let you know how powerful those people are. When people are in government, it's as if they are being caged. And whatever action they want to take, they have to look at their surroundings. How will it go with this person? Will it go down well with this person? You see, it is just part of the politics that we play. Okay. Because those people, some people are the power behind the throne, who determine, who decides who becomes the president. Okay. You and I will just go out on the day of election and begin to vote. We are voting for these people they have put before
us as the real candidate.
That is the unfortunate aspect. And we are shouting, hey, democracy, my candidate has won. It is the candidate, you think your candidate is somebody that has been put forward by some people. So,
unfortunately, we're out of time, Mr. Layoko.
The paper presented by the former president should be like a case study for politicians to go and look into it.
Okay.
If we can look into this paper and begin to make amends, you will see that we'll be able to sanitize our democracy.
All right.
Our democracy needs to be sanitized.
All right, Adewale, we have just a few seconds. Please, quickly, can you respond to that?
Yeah, I beg to disagree with the former speaker on the concept of the president being powerful enough to get some things implemented. I want him to recall that in Nigeria, and up to today, presidents implement executive orders. You see, the issue with us in Africa and in Nigeria particularly is leadership irresponsibility and the fear of being not being re-elected. See, a woman, like we were saying, even a woman in Israel in those days, Esther, she said, if I die, I die. Our leaders would not want to do a lot of things because they fear being not re-elected.
Okay.
Do you understand?
Okay.
The president is a man with sufficient order, sufficient powers, and sufficient instrumentality of office to achieve whatever. If you read what Nasir El-Rufai chronicled in that book, you will see how President Olusegun Obasanjo sought a lot of things and got them done.
Okay.
So if you have a leader that is sensible and sensitive and is committed to the wills and the good of the land, it will achieve a lot. It's only a fearful president, a mindless president, a very, very, very unreasonable president, if I may say, that would hang on to cling onto the hints of the fact that he has little to do. Executive orders remain an executive implement for any president to achieve a lot of things.
Well, gentlemen, we're out of time. Unfortunately, we are out of time. I want to say thank you.
You understand?
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Time is not on our side. Digbo Olayoko is a journalist, and Adewale Adekoya is a political
activist. Adewale
Ademola Justice. Thank you very much for being part of the conversation.
It's always a pleasure.
All right. Well, we'll have to take a short break. When we come back, we'll be talking about other issues because the PDP Governors Forum is telling us what President Buhari is not doing right. Well, we'll get to find out what it is when we come back after this break.